What's going on, everybody? Welcome to the Foundation First Fitness Show. Thank you very much for tuning in again. Today is episode 16, and it is once again a Q&A session. I know I put two of these Q&A sessions together pretty soon. I've actually started to really like Q&A sessions. I feel like I'm more comfortable there. It's kind of what I've liked to do for a while, and it's actually a lot more comfortable for me to do Q&As. And the reason for that is that I feel like it's more directed to questions you all actually have and not just me guessing what you guys want to hear me talk about. So if you have questions, drop a comment, send me an email, let me know what you guys want answered, and I'll get them on this show. And also, if you guys have any comments or questions about something that I've said in one of my Q&A sessions, let me know, and I'll definitely try to clear that up for any of you. But let's not waste any more time. Let's get right into it. I always want to keep these shows under 12 minutes, so let's get right to it. Now, the first question comes from Brian in Calgary. He asks, is a pec fly or a dumbbell fly or a chest fly, there's just a bunch of different names for them. Basically, when you bring your arms out to the side and you're bringing the weights back in front of you, I'm trying not to fall back as I do this, is that a great exercise? And I think I know what he's referring to when he asked that question. There's a couple of things, there's a couple of reasons you could ask that question. A, it could be because you're worried about the shoulder and what's actually happening at the shoulder, and is it causing a little bit more tension at the shoulder than another exercise? It could also be potentially at the elbow, because you are in that extended position, that elbow is actually the biceps resisting a lot of that stress. So that could be another area where you might be concerned. And the third thing is it actually going to be loading up that pec as much? Now, the reason I think a lot of this kind of came about is that a lot of people have been asking about whether this single joint exercise is actually going to be really good for the chest versus a compound exercise like the bench press. So I'll be honest, I don't really use it all that often. The pec fly is not one of my go-to exercises. And the reason for that is I have very limited time with my athletes and I have very limited time with my clients. And sometimes I'm trying to be nitpicky with the exercises that I use. And oftentimes I fall into patterns where I like working with certain exercises more than others because I like the benefits that they're going to give. Now, having said that, there is a time and a place where I will use the pec fly. But before I do that, before I talk about where I will use it, I want to refer back to some of the questions about the shoulder, the bicep, the tension on the chest, and is it going to be generating enough force? It's a really interesting question, actually. The shoulder, it is a fairly stable joint if you've trained it to be stable. If it's an unstable joint, you might feel tension at it, especially if you have rotator cuff issues or if you have a biceps tendon issue, which generally kind of goes hand in hand with that bicep issue. And the reason that shoulder issue, rotator cuff, and bicep kind of go hand in hand, the reason for that is that when we are out in this stretch position, our bicep is taking a lot of the load because of where that weight is placed, but also the shoulder is an attachment point for that bicep. So the muscle that's on the front of the arm. Now, because it's crossing both of those joints, what ends up happening is that it's kind of pulling from both ends. And what that ends up doing is that's actually increasing the load on that muscle itself. Now, oftentimes, as I mentioned, when you have a rotator cuff problem, there is a high chance that your bicep tendon kind of falls into it. And the reason it falls into it is because of the posture and so on and so forth. But not to get into too much into that, but that's where your bicep your shoulder and the issues or relationship of your shoulder could be another problem. But again, if you don't have any shoulder problems, it shouldn't be causing shoulder pain. You should be more than able to do it. Again, you might not want to increase that load too much. Don't look at other people do it, because this is one of those exercises where if you have a longer arm or if your limbs are longer, like if you have a long reach, the longer your reach is, the larger that moment arm or that length from the weights to the joint is, and the larger that resistance is going to be when that arm gets all the way out there and gets extended out. So you want to make sure that you're not overdoing that. Now, the thing about the elbow is very much related to that bicep. So if you feel like you're pulling a bit too much on it, you might feel some soreness in the bicep too because of that biceps and the brachialis muscle, though basically those big time muscles that are inside that elbow that are kind of stabilizing that elbow joint. They might be under a little bit of stress because of the where that weight is going to be placed when you are doing that fly. So when that happens, the issue that you want to make sure you're not falling into is you don't want to end up kind of overextending it, overworking it, which would cause either the elbow or the shoulder joint to go. Now, is that exercise actually effective? Is it actually targeting the chest that much? Because we are loading a lot less weight than we would with that bench press. Now, when you're trying to put on muscle, it's obvious that volume is a huge factor. The other thing is range of motion and the weight, which kind of ties into that volume. So if you can add more weight onto it, it's obviously going to help increase the amount of muscle tears. And if you're adding weight and volume together and that kind of, you're bringing up the volume by increasing the amount of weight as well, what that's going to do is that's actually going to create more muscle growth. Now, the reason the range of motion won't really change between the two is that because when you are in that bench press, when we are looking at the range of motion at the shoulder, it's really the same as if my arm was out here. There is no difference in range. What makes it difficult is because the weight is so much further out and because I'm not in a mechanical advantage, which is a key factor, my pec is actually under a significant amount of stress just because that, even though that weight is actually very light, it is all the way out there creating that tension on my pec. Now, where I would use it and why I would use the fly as one of the exercises in my workouts is if I had someone who had a significant difference in the amount of tricep strength to pec strength, and when they were pressing, they wanted to get a little bit more pec work because their triceps were kind of taking over that load when they are doing that pressing. And their pecs aren't taking a lot of that load, what you would do is you would kind of create that reverse pattern where you would work your pec more and kind of target it and kind of specifically target it and not so much get that tricep involved. So when you are in a case where you're trying to overload that pec and kind of get it to work because your tricep isn't the stronger muscle, what ends up happening, and that's why you would feel that target, is if your tricep's not the strongest muscle, it's going to be the one doing the majority of the work. And sometimes you want that pec to tire out when you're trying to load it up. So you would start off with a fly to kind of tire out and isolate that muscle, then lead yourself into a bench press where your pec would be a little bit more fatigued and able to kind of get a little bit of work done there. The other time you could do it is if you did something called a pre-exhaust. And a pre-exhaust is a great way to build muscle, but it's a little bit more advanced. And what a pre-exhaust is essentially like doing a hamstring curl and then a squat, right? Hamstring is part of a squat. You want to get more hamstring work, do a hamstring curl before you do a squat. You're going to get more hamstring involvement, or you're going to feel it more when you are doing that squat. So you're basically trying to tire out the muscle right before you do it. So you add them together. They go back to back like a superset. So do your fly, then do your press, and you should be good to go on that kind of pec fly kind of area. Now, I want to quickly get into number two because I don't want to forget this question. This question comes from Elisa. It is, what is the number one, or sorry, the most overrated weight loss tip? Sorry, underrated weight loss tip, overrated. The most underrated weight loss tip. Now, this was something that actually kind of got me thinking because I really have to start understand or kind of going over the entire component. I think I just knocked something over. The entire component or the entire process of losing weight. And I think the most underrated component, the most underrated piece of information and the aspect that we kind of overlook very often is sleep. Sleep is probably one of those areas where a lot of us are lacking, especially when you're trying to lose weight. And the reason it's such a huge factor is because when you're not sleeping, you're actually increasing the amount of stress that's going on in your body. The stress hormones are going to go up. Cortisol is going to go up. Leptin and ghrelin levels, which are two hormones that are going to regulate your eating, are actually going to be very heavily affected by your sleep patterns. The other thing that's going to happen is we're actually going to create this vicious cycle. So because of our leptin and ghrelin, which are hormones that are, like I said, are affecting your eating habits, it's going to change you to it's going to cause you to alter the way you're going to eat. So you're going to become hungrier. It's going to trigger your appetite, the appetite sensation in the areas of your brain. It's going to make you want to eat more. And because of that, your body's actually going to start taking in foods. But the other thing it's going to do is it's actually going to start making you crave foods that are unhealthy for you. So the sugars, the fatty foods, it very much targets those areas and causes you to want to eat those foods. The other thing that happens is because of that, you end up going through these spikes and these kind of peaks and valleys of fatigue. And what you end up doing is increasing the amount of coffee you take in your day. Now, because you're increasing the amount of coffee you take in a day, your sleeping pattern's off. So you see how that kind of becomes a little bit of a vicious cycle where you sleep poorly, so you eat poorly, so then you drink more coffee, so you sleep poorly, and you blah, 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 and just kind of keep cycling and cycling and cycling through. And you end up never really getting a hold of that weight loss that weight loss goal that you're trying to get to. So increase the amount of sleep and increase the quality of sleep. Quality of sleep is very important. It's often overlooked. We generally talk solely about time and, you know, getting that 7 to 9 hours or 8 hours roughly of sleep. And we talk about, you know, the mattress and all these different factors and, you know, and making sure that we actually get enough sleep and turning off our TVs and turning off our cell phones, which while those are extremely important, sleep quality is such a huge factor. So I would definitely tell you that the most underrated component is going to be sleep. I think it's something that we all really need to start paying attention to. And I think I might do an episode pretty soon on tips for sleep. Okay. Really appreciate you guys listening. I hope that you guys start shooting some questions out to me. Subscribe if you haven't subscribed on YouTube, and let me know what you guys think in the comments. Guys, thank you so much for paying attention. And until next time, guys, keep building that foundation.